Welcome to Vintage Jazz Sundays with your host, Marion Meadows.
Episode of Vintage Jazz Sundays. I'm Marion Meadows. And you know, we've been talking about this for a long time, and here we are, finally. You know, I'm passionate about a lot of things. I'm passionate about cycling, and I'm passionate about art, and I'm certainly passionate about jazz. So we're going to go back through these next few episodes and step back in time and see if there are missing pieces to our puzzle. And certainly, you know, jazz changed the world. Our children should know that. They should know our history. It's a rich, valuable history. And again, it changed the world. So you ask yourself, how much do you know about our jazz history? Well, we'll find out tonight. We're going to go back to Congo Square in New Orleans, and we're going to look up Buddy Bolden and Johnny Dodd, Sidney Bechet, Jelly Roll Morton, Lester Young, Coleman Hawkins. We're going to talk about King Oliver, Kid Ory, Louis Armstrong, Ma Rainey, Ethel Waters. And we're going to talk about all these artists and how they influence one another. Billie Holiday, Ella Fitzgerald, Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Dizzy Gillespie, and the modern day artists of today, many of which are my friends. And some of them are my special guests on this show. I'm not going to tell you who they are yet. So let's dig down into this treasure chest of archival gems and see what we can find. Let's get started.
Motown's session players rarely stepped out on their own. The lone exception to that rule was tenor sax man Junior Walker, whose rough and ready style was inspired by jump blues and early R&B. Particularly players like Louis Jordan, Earl Bostic, and Illinois Jacquette. Let's step back and see what these soulful tenor players were laying down. Then there was Louis Jordan.
Hey, what you doing, man? Cut it. Hey, what you gonna do? That ain't the piece we supposed to play. Come on.
Well, I guess I better get on in here with it.
Hey, with my baby, she got great big feet. She's long, lean, and lanky, and ain't had nothing to eat. But she's my baby, and I love her just the same. Crazy about that woman, cause Caledonia is her name. Caledonia! Caledonia! What make your big head so hard? Mom, I love you. Love you just the same. I'll always love you, baby, cause Caledonia is your name. She said, son, Caledonia's bad for your morale, son. Keep away from her. But Mama didn't know I was in love with Caledonia. So I'm going down to Caledonia's house and ask her just one more time. Caledonia! Caledonia! What make your big head so hot?
You never heard of Louis Jordan? I'm just kidding. But if you haven't heard of Louis Jordan, that's what we're here for. I hope you're having a great time so far, because we got so much to talk about and so many artists to check out. So now, we're going to go back to the beginning. We're heading back to New Orleans. This is the late 1700s. The place is Congo Square. And on Sundays, in the late 1700s into the 1800s, for over 100 years, slaves had a free day. And they would gather in Congo Square, sing and dance, and this would set the stage for what we know as modern jazz. Check it out.
From the late 1700s until emancipation, slaves were allowed to gather in Congo Square in New Orleans on Sundays, often referred to as their free day.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
African slaves, and later on, immigrants from Europe, Asia, and Mexico would become the backbone of America's success. Who knew that they would also be the backbone of America's true culture? A gift this so-called land of opportunity would not see coming.
Hi, I'm speaking to you from Charleston, South Carolina, a city whose history is primarily based on the unprecedented role that it played in bringing slaves to America and its impact on American history. You know, I think that when remembering the transatlantic slave trade, it's easy to dwell on the horrors and the experiences of slavery. As you well know, slaves were often prohibited from practicing traditional religions and customs. So they created new languages and dialects to hide elements of their culture from their oppressors. Historians trace the origins of jazz to a number of different cultures and societal influences that converged in 19th century New Orleans. Most significant was the import of slaves from Africa and the West Indies, along with the refugees who fled Hispaniola to escape the bloodshed of the Haitian Revolution. In the early 1800s, slaves gathered in Congo Square in New Orleans to perform their traditional music as well as dance. Records from the time show that slaves used string instruments, improvised, and played drums in a polyrhythmic fashion, what we refer to today as syncopation. Two types of African-American songs were important to the development of jazz, spirituals and work songs. Work songs combine the rhythm of work with singing. It's a tradition closely related to the cultures of West Africa. These songs were used to synchronize a group as they work together, with a leader calling out and the rest of the group responding. Many historians attribute the call and response pattern in jazz to this early form of African American music. The earliest jazz musicians were born within a short time of slavery. It remained a vivid memory passed down from older family members who lived before the Emancipation Proclamation. The early days of jazz were not very well documented. Buddy Bolden, who is commonly considered the first jazz musician, was born in 1877, and the first jazz bands are reported to have come on the scene around 1885. Sadly, music from this early period was never recorded. Africans, people from the Caribbean and Europeans, Scottish, English, Irish, French, Spanish, and Italians made distinct contributions to the New Orleans melting pot. Over time, these cultures began to borrow and adopt from each other's traditions and music. The lasting influence of the Congo Square spirituals, the blues, Creole music, European classical music, and brass bands combined to make the earliest forms of jazz.
At the turn of the century, ragtime was all the craze. Scott Joplin achieved fame for his ragtime compositions and was dubbed the king of ragtime. During his brief career, he wrote over 100 original ragtime pieces, one ragtime ballet, and two operas. Scott Joplin died in 1917, just as jazz was coming on the scene. Buddy Bolden, who legend credits as the earliest jazz musician. Freddie Keppard, a jazz cornetist who once held the title King of the New Orleans Jazz Scene. This title was previously held by Buddy Bolden and succeeded by Joe Oliver. One of the most important of the New Orleans jazz pioneers, cornetist Joe King Oliver is perhaps best remembered today for leading the best jazz band of 1923 and for his connection with Louis Armstrong. A young Louis Armstrong, pictured here, second from right, next to Oliver. Creole-born Jelly Roll Morton was widely recognized as a pivotal figure in early jazz. Morton was jazz's first arranger. Jelly Roll's Jelly Roll Blues, published in 1915, would mark the very first jazz song ever published. French-speaking trombonist Edward Kidd Ory, born on Christmas Day, 1886. Ory would pioneer the role of the trombone in three-part jazz improvisation. Kidd Ory would go on to play with King Oliver's Dixie Syncopators, Louis Armstrong's Hot Five, and Jelly Roll Morton's Red Hot Peppers. Bessie Smith, born in 1894, was nicknamed Queen of the Blues. Smith's music stressed independence, fearlessness, and sexual freedom. She argued that working class women did not have to alter their behavior to be worthy of respect. Bessie Smith was the highest paid black entertainer
of her day. Sidney Joseph Bechet was born in New Orleans in 1897 to a middle-class Creole family. His older brother, Leonard, was a full-time dentist and part-time trombonist. Bechet was a prodigy on several instruments, but decided to specialize in the clarinet. At the age of 6, he started playing with his brother's band, and by the age of 10, Bechet was a professional musician, playing around town. In 1919, Bechet would join Will Marion Cook's syncopated orchestra. The group soon traveled to Europe, where they would perform at the Royal Philharmonic Hall in London. Bechet was warmly received, and while in London, he discovered the straight soprano saxophone and developed a style unlike his clarinet tone. His saxophone style was often described as emotional, reckless, and large. Bechet would go on to work with the likes of Josephine Baker, and in 1919, Ernest Azermet, a Swiss conductor of classical music, wrote a tribute to Bechet. One of the earliest, if not the first, to a jazz musician from the field of classical music, linking Bechet's music with that of Bach.
By the time Bolden and Bechet began playing jazz, the Americanization of African music had already begun, and with it came the Africanization of American music. This synergistic process is called syncretism, the blending together of cultural elements that previously existed separately. This dynamic, so essential to the history of jazz, remains powerful, even in present day, when African-American styles of performance blend seamlessly with the music of other cultures, European, Asian, Latin, and coming full circle back to Africa. Ted Gioia.
Amen. Sidney Bechet. It took me moving, actually, I guess, at initially as a 19-year-old, studying in Paris, and hearing the French jazz fans talk about Sidney Bechet, this American jazz saxophonist, who came over and completely just changed the game. And, you know, because it was pretty much, you know, marching music and classical, Western classical music. And Sidney came over and, man, just lit the world up with this thing that he had learned down south in New Orleans. And, you know, I'll say that, you know, since that time, I've had a chance to really dig deeper into his music and his style and the innovation that he brought. And, man, it's just such an incredible feeling of pride to be able to say I'm an American jazz musician, you know, and that I play the instrument that Sidney Bechet also played, you know. Marion Meadows plays that instrument. A lot of great musicians, you know, Branford Marsalis played the soprano saxophone. And then, by the way, that was an innovative, the instrument itself was an innovation at that time, right? You had the clarinet, which was made out of wood, initially made out of wood, and then eventually, because they were trying to get that sound in the outdoor marching band setting, and the wood would just crack because it was so cold in Belgium and Austria, Germany. And so this guy, Adolf Sachs, in 1864, I believe, invented this instrument. And here we are today, you know, Adolf Sachs, his name was literally Sachs, playing the saxophone. And Sidney Bechet was one of the first to innovate on the soprano saxophone in particular. It was such a new and novel sound at that time. So anyway, I'm honored that I can say that in some, you know, distant way, our paths connect, and I'm grateful. I'm Kirk Whalen.
You've been watching Vintage Jazz Sundays, an MM Entertainment production.
On our next episode, a young Louis Armstrong completely changes the game.
Join us next time for part 2 of Vintage Jazz Sundays with your host, Marion Meadows.